Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Mary Jo Sconce, and I will be the lector, one of the lectors, and our presider will be Father Bob Hazel from Cross Catholic Church. And we are celebrating the third Sunday in Ordinary Time. The announcements are as follows. Registration forms are in the gathering space for the 2022 Castaway Retreat for the youth in 9th to 12th grade. Castaway provides young people with a weekend to step away from the craziness of life and to encounter God's love. Through praise and worship music, faith testimonies, hilarious skits, mass, reconciliation, amazing food, a dance, and so much more. If you have questions, contact Scott Friesler in the Faith Formation Office. The men's group will meet on Tuesday, January 25th at 7:15 p.m. in the Great Hall. All men of the parish are invited to join us for the meeting and camaraderie afterwards. We'll see you there. The U.S. Bishop's Pastoral on Stewardship reinforces today's reading from the 1 Corinthians. Because its individual members do collectively make up the body of Christ, the body's health and well-being are the responsibility of each of the members, the personal responsibility of each one of us. We are all stewards of the church. At this time, I would like to invite you to please stand and greet those with whom you are worshiping. Please join in singing our gathering song, number 850, All Are Welcome.
Jesus, all of us. Indeed, you are all welcome here, and it's a pleasure to be here again. I've been here, I was here a few years ago, and I'm here again mostly on behalf of Cross Catholic Outreach, about which I'll talk in the homily, but pay special attention today to the second of the readings. It's Paul's letter to the Corinthians. And remember the situation. Somebody had been there before, and there was already some kind of a Christian community. But first of all, Corinth was notorious in those times as being the place of discord and evil and sin and robbery and prostitution and on and on. They were known for that. And the small Christian community there even got into the action of the sort of outlaws. So Paul is trying to counsel them, and he gives a great example of how they should be working together. And it's a great example not only for us in church, but I think it has far-reaching things for country and our world these days, where there is so much division and enmity. It's a great reading. We're reading from Corinthians, second reading all for several weeks. So we ask God to hear us in our pleas, and we ask God to take care of us and have mercy upon us for our lack of persevering faith that takes us through hard and difficult decisions. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And sometimes for our just sitting back, a mild means of just resting on our laurels, because we have no hope for things to be brighter and more cheerful and more loving. Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
And for our failure to extend the power of our love to help others and to help ourselves in the process, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy upon us, forgive us any sin, bring us to life everlasting.
Amen. Amen.
Receive our prayer.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, direct our actions according to your good pleasure, that in the name of Jesus, your beloved Son, we may abound in good works in our life, for he is our Lord forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Nehemiah. Ezra, the priest, brought the law before the assembly, which consisted of men, women, and those children old enough to understand. Standing at one end of the open place that was before the water gate, he read out of the book from daybreak till midday, in the presence of the men, the women, and those children old enough to understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra, the scribe, stood on a wooden platform that had been made for the occasion. He opened the scroll so that all the people might see it, for he was standing higher than any of the people. And as he opened it, all the people rose. Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people, their hands raised high, answered, "Amen, amen." Then they bowed down and prostrated themselves before the Lord, their faces to the ground. Ezra read plainly from the book of the law of God, interpreting it so that all could understand what was read. Then Nehemiah, that is, His Excellency, and Ezra, the prescribe, and the Levites, who were instructing the people, said to all the people, "Today is holy to the Lord your God. Do not be sad. Do not weep." For all the people were weeping as they heard the words of the law. He said further, "Go eat rich foods and drink sweet drinks, and allot portions for those who had nothing prepared. For today is holy to our Lord. Do not be saddened this day, for rejoicing in the Lord must be your strength." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Stronger than death, your words are spirit. is right, they gladden the hearts of people. God's command is so clear, it brings us new vision, bringing God's light to our eyes. Your words are spirit and life, O Lord, richer than gold, stronger than death. Your words are spirit and life, O Lord, life everlasting. Living by God's truth is holy and sure, God's presence is everlasting. God's truth is eternal, bringing us justice, bringing God's justice to earth.
Your words are spirit and life, O Lord, richer than gold, stronger than death. Your words are spirit and life, O Lord, life
everlasting. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, as a body is one, though it has many parts, and all the parts of the body, though many, are one body, so also Christ. For in one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slaves or free persons. And we were all given to drink of one Spirit. Now the body is not a single part, but many. If a foot should say, "Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body," it does not for this reason belong any less to the body. Or if an ear should say, "Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body," it does not for this reason belong any less to the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God placed the parts, each one of them, in the body as he intended. If there were all one part, where would the body be? But as it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, "I do not need you." Nor again the head to the feet, "I do not need you." Indeed, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are all the more necessary. And those parts of the body that we consider less honorable, we surround with great honor, and our less presentable parts are treated with greater propriety, whereas our more presentable parts do not need this. But God has so constructed the body as to give greater honor to a part that is without it, so that there may be no division in the body, but that the parts may have the same concern for one another. If one part suffers, all the parts suffer with it. If one part is honored, all the parts share its joy. Now you are Christ's body and individually parts of it. Some people God has designated in the church to be, first, apostles, second, prophets, third, teachers, then mighty deeds, then gifts of healing, assistance, administration, and varieties of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work mighty deeds? Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
From the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Since many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the events that have been fulfilled among us, just as those who were eyewitnesses from the beginning and ministers of the word have handed down to us, I, Luke, too have decided, after investigating everything adequately anew, to write it down in an orderly sequence for you, so that you may realize the certainty of the teaching you have received. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. News of him spread throughout the whole region. He taught in the synagogues and was praised by all. He came to Nazareth, where he had grown up, and went according to the custom into the synagogue on the Sabbath day. He stood up to read and was handed the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. Jesus unrolled the scroll and found the passage where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring glad tidings to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim a year acceptable to the Lord." Rolling up the scroll, Jesus handed it back to the attendant and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue looked intently at him. Jesus said, "Today this scripture passage is fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As you are beseating yourself, these wonderful ushers are going to pass out these brochures, one for every family for sure, one for every families of husbands and wives, each want one, they can have it, one for every single adult, one for every aspiring adult. I will get to that because we will look at a few pictures in a moment. I know that everyone has been through a lot in the last couple of years. There's been a lot of confusion. There still is confusion. There's been a lot of hurt. There's been a lot of crashes. It's affected us politically, even in our churches, even in our neighborhoods. Things have not been real positive for the world as a whole. That's why this reading from Paul to the Corinthians is so very important, because that was the situation among the Corinthians, and Paul comes to them. And I come bringing a similar message. It's the best message I can think of for Cross. Remember Cross, Catholic Outreach? I've been here before. You all remember that place, don't you? Anybody forgot? You stand? No. In a phrase, I can say, and I'll repeat, Cross is that the poor, the poorest, have regular access to basic necessities. That's very basic. What does this mean, a little bit expanded? At Cross Catholic Outreach, in over 200 well-defined projects every year in more than 30 countries, and they look, and Cross secondly works through loving and caring ministers. Some of them are nuns, some of them are priests, some of them are very dedicated laity, foreign and indigenous to them, and they're caring for the poor. Cross is not a place that just drives into a place or a village with a truck full of disposable goods, unloads it, has the photo app, and then everybody leaves. Cross people are continuously there, present to the people working with them. That's the difference. And every single project of Cross is calculated to bring about a permanent and a substantial change in the life of the people. Okay, so what does Cross do? Cross does work with individuals. Feeding is very important. You can see some of the pictures in there of feeding, like right on the very front, a nun. I've never seen a nun in one of these foreign places with such a clean outfit. I should tell Cross that in their thing. But anyways, feeding is very important, but just to give somebody a food once in a while doesn't really cut it. There has to be a system that works into that. And Cross pushes to have these systems. And the most important system that Cross does, if you open it up to the very center, you can see two structures with people in front of them. One is what I call a shed. That is where that family has been living for years. That's their whole home. It leaks, dirt floor, it's almost falling apart. But see, the next picture over there is a small home. It's small, but it's really built. It's the difference between a shed that's falling apart and the real home. Cross is very big on building homes and helping people with families to get into them. Now, think of what a home means to you and to me. I just took a little check. What is a home? It's where we can keep our belongings safe, create healthy meals, have some private space, entertain the family, welcome friends, deal with distress, care for sickness, study, prepare for the future. That's what a home is. And Cross is very big on building homes. And many of you know I worked in mission myself. I'm a diocesan priest, but I worked in Bombay, the area of Bombay in India, and I was in mid-70s, and from 79 to 85 in Venezuela. And I found that when people come into what can be called a home like this, it's the distinction, it's between pure destitution living and dire poverty to hope. And that's why Cross is so big on building homes. Now, I'm not going to talk anymore about homes, but you can see what it is. And I promote that. I promote that, along with everything else. But let me tie it in today with that wonderful reading from Corinthians. Corinthians, where there was great discourse, disagreement, and fighting, and robbery, and it was a center of evil in that area. Paul comes there, and he uses a wonderful example, and that is something we carry around with us all the time, the human body. Think of, he mentions just the big things, but think of the millions of operations that go on in your body, for the most part smoothly, every day, whether you're awake or asleep. It's little parts working together, working together, working together, and the whole body prospers because of that. No one of us is everything to everybody. We're part of the body. We're part of the body of Christ. And we each have our own goodness. We each have our own talents. We each have our own projections of what we can do in order to be and help and move others and to bring about peace and security. Now, I have often said, what is it, the spiritual part of mission? All mission is about faith. And what does faith do for us? Faith leads us to know and realize our human dignity. And that is all essential. Very big essential. Our human dignity. And it's much better to see human dignity in people who gather together in a reasonable dwelling. That's why Cross is so big on homes. And secondly, it enriches us with a community. That's what parishes are. And that's why Cross in the latter years has tried to build up a little community of homes together, not on top of each other. There's one here, there's one there, there's maybe several in this whole big space. But so they have room, and so their children can play, so they can have gardens, so they can have space. Big thing, so they can plant trees. And trees, that's a great thing of hope. This is an aside, but I was in several parishes in the Twin City area in my life, And in every single parish that I was at, I remember one night, 10 o'clock at night, the next day I was being relieved to pastor to go someplace else, and I was out digging and planting the tree. I've planted the tree in virtually every parish I've been in. It's a sign of hope, I think. And that's what people are doing. So, this is Cross. You can read more. I'd ask you to read that page and make an impact, because it gives you some of the standards. And some will look and say, oh, that's very, very expensive. But $2,500 for a home is not all that expensive for a family that has nothing. You can do that over the course of months also. But think of it this way. Maybe you can do a part of it. Maybe you can do half or a part, and somebody else will do the other part. So think big. You can contribute to Cross in three different ways. You notice this comes apart, and this is an envelope, and you can put something in, you can fill it out, give it to me at the entrance to the church after Mass. You can take it home, pray about it, read the whole thing, read it aloud with your family, decide together as a family, and mail it in because it's addressed and stamped. Okay? Third way is, says in there something about electronic giving, but don't ask me how to do that because I do not have the foggiest. And I'm not learning any better as time goes on. Anyways, I leave you with two short quotations. One is from Francis Assisi. It is in giving that we receive. It is opening up our heart that we really come to maturity as a living, heartfelt person. And secondly is what we say every day, or at least several times a week in the Lord's Prayer. Give us today our daily bread. We're asking for God. We need daily food for both our body and our spirit every day. We need it in order to be real, live, not only humans, but Christians, part of the body of Christ. So I thank you for your attention. I will be out there after Mass to answer any questions or to receive any envelopes that are fulfilled this night. But make sure you have one, and make sure you consider it very seriously. God bless you. Thank you. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen. After listening to the Word of God, we're asking God to listen to us in these our petitions.
May the Church strive to uplift the voices of all people, especially people who might be otherwise ignored or overlooked. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For safety in regions throughout the world affected by power, might, and tension, may peaceable solutions be found. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the courage to promote God's love for the poor and oppressed in families, neighborhoods, and workplaces, and for the impact cross-Catholic outreach makes throughout the world with generous community support. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a change of heart from indifference of life to understanding the profound sacredness and dignity of all human life, from womb to natural death, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the recently deceased of our community, and for all of our loved ones who have died. May they rejoice in the heavenly banquet. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord God, hear us in our pleas. Hear us and help us, and guide us to be your people in word and in action through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Please turn to number 834 and join us in singing We Are Many Parts at number 834.
Let us be your love to all of our
Pray now that our sacrifice may be acceptable to Almighty God.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, and the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
O Lord, we pray that you accept these gifts we present, to sanctify them, that they may help and profit us for our own salvation, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just. Our duty, our salvation, always, everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. Fulfilling your will and gain for you a holy people, Jesus stretched out his hands as he endured the passion, so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. So we join the angels and saints in proclaiming your glory as we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending your Spirit like the dew, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus the Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, Jesus took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice with wine, once more giving you thanks. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. You do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memory of the death and resurrection of Jesus, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. So remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Bernard, our Bishop, with the clergy, the religious, all the holy people of God. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with Mary, the Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, with all the apostles, the martyrs, the saints, throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, to praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus. For it is through Christ, with Christ, in Christ. O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. So we join our minds, our hearts, our voices to pray even as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior, Jesus the Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
May the peace of the Lord be with all of you.
With your spirit.
Offer with each other some sign of peace in Christ. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are all called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Please turn to number 932 and join us in singing One Bread, One Body.
So let us pray. Almighty God, we address you as Almighty, for we receive from you grace by which you bring us always to a renewed life, and we will come to share in the glory of your presence as your gift. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Once again, I'm just very happy to be here. I keep thinking about Corinthians and how Paul was trying to overcome all the divisions and the enmity, not only of the few Christians there, but of the whole. And we have a task to do that. And we can do that in various ways. I think one way is cross. So pay special attention to that. You chip away at various things. And I mentioned, pick one of the projects. And if you can't do the whole thing, do part of it. So thank you for your presence. I'll be out in the lobby to answer any questions. Let us go forth in the peace of the Lord.
Thanks. Thanks be to God.
As we go forth, please turn to number 607 and to join us in singing Sing a New Song.
Cool.
For the coolest trip.
Yeah.
That little sojourn.